This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
We're talking to Jacquelin Smith. Her new book, Star Being in the Mirror, My Journey as a Hybrid. And we have, I won't lie, folks, had a lot of trouble getting this show going because, in my opinion, Jacquelin is a close encounter witness, as you will find, has a very different experience from mine. And I think it's going to be very interesting to talk about. But we both have implants. And I think there was something going on between the two implants because we had all this static. And now we're trying to do this on Zoom, which I don't usually use. I usually use StreamYard, as you know. And hopefully we'll be all right. Jacquelin is, her website is Jacquelin, J-A-C-Q-U-L-I-N, no end in E, Smith. JacquelinSmith.com. The book is Star Being in the Mirror. It is a life story of a person having a close encounter lifetime. Very, very different from my own. And that's an important thing to understand here, that it is different. And she's had, in many ways, a better experience, I think, than I have had. And that makes it really interesting. Now I'm getting, just to warn everyone, and yet to warn you, Jacquelin, power outage notices that there's power outages in my area. I would like to welcome you to Dreamland. God help us both. But, you know, before we start, I'd like to talk about something very odd that happened to both of us. And it's much worse in Jacquelin's case than in mine. I'll briefly describe it. I went to the eye doctor for an annual exam and had my eyes dilated, as they have been dilated at every annual exam and all of my life. And the same thing always happens. It gets very bright, and then that subsides for a while. After a while, this time it was very different. As soon as he dilated my eyes, it was a haze, blurry fog. And I was absolutely terrified because it was non-viable. I couldn't see anymore. I had to sit there waiting for an hour for it to clear up. It finally did, thank God. You weren't so lucky. What happened to you?
Yes, I went for my yearly eye exam, and they put the drops in, and my vision has never been the same since. So what happened was I immediately had very blurry vision and hypersensitivity to light, as if my eyes were still dilated. And so I am unfortunately still having those, those things going on. And it's been quite a journey.
My heart goes out to you, I have to tell you, because, you know, for some reason, the people who are in this experience have eye problems. And I think it's sensitivity to unusual forms of light. I have only partial vision left in this eye. I mean, it's not incapacitating. I can still safely drive and everything. But it happened after I there's a place I can go where I can see into another reality. And my listeners know about this, and they know, most of them have read my book, A New World, which describes this other reality in great detail. But ever since then, my eyes have been sensitive. And one time I was doing that, and I came home, and I suddenly went nearly blind in this eye. Yeah. And I don't do it much anymore because I'd rather keep my vision, you know. It's fascinating to look into another world, certainly, but not if it costs you your eyesight. Okay. Yes. Well, I can only say this. I hope your eyesight improves. My blessings upon you. But this goes back, though. You had other experiences with your vision that weren't negative at all. Is that correct?
Correct. I mean, when I had experiences during what I call my Thanksgiving experiences. I had to wear glasses to read. And when, when they had taken me on a ship, a mothership, the star beams actually did lasers. They sent laser beams into my eyes. And so when I was back at my computer, I had put on my glasses and I couldn't see well. And after that, I took off my glasses and I could see perfectly. So I realized that they had actually healed my eyes then.
But then later this happened. Maybe they'll come back and heal it again.
Well, I'm asking.
I'll bet you are. Boy, I can't. As I say, my heart goes out to you. Well, let's go back, though, because you and I have very different experiences. The visitors I'm with have what could be described as a heavy-handed, sardonic sense of humor when it comes to me. I don't get all the cool stuff you do. I want to talk about the cool stuff, and I'm sure my listeners and viewers do, too. So let's go back to your early childhood and what happened to you back in the day when you were just noticing that this was in your life.
Well, actually, it started, it started when my mother was taken on a ship. And the star beings injected her with, I call it a cocktail of seven different kinds of DNA from seven different races. And
when
so
you say races, you mean races not human?
Correct.
Okay.
And so that's why, in that sense, I call myself a hybrid. It's something that a lot of people understand in that way. So they genetically altered me.
You notice how Jacquelin refers to them as races. People who are outside of the experience refer to them as species, but that's not how they think of themselves. I've been told that we're not different species, we're different races. That conscious life is one species and it's got a lot of different races. So you probably were told that too sometime in your life. Tell us about your mother and what happened with her.
Well, she was not really, she did not remember these experiences because the star beings communicated with me and told me they had intentionally blocked her memories because she wouldn't have been able to handle it. So, but she always said to me, you're different. And I think she had a hard time with that. And of course, on the subconscious level, knew that, you know, what had happened. And even though she wasn't aware of it, you know, on both sides of my family, the lineage goes way, way back to working with star beings and the hybridization programs and all of that. So I was the one chosen in the family to be the hybrid. My brothers are not. In the larger sense, we're all hybrids. I mean, because we come from the stars. So I'm using it in regard to being genetically altered because they literally altered my DNA. And so I have a really high, we could call frequency in within my etheric bodies and multidimensionally of star being. And I feel very star being.
Well, you know, they must have altered my DNA to put my to sink my feet into the cement, because I'm very definitely on the ground. Let me ask you this: when your mother said you were different, what was prompting her to say that?
Well, I really was different in many ways. As a child, I felt like I never fit in anywhere, which is typical. And I had a challenging time in school because on the ship at night, I was speaking star languages and that, which are all multidimensional, not linear. So when I was trying to learn how to read, to write, and that, it was a challenge for me. And my mother really thought of me as not being, I think, very smart in those ways. And so, but for me, it was about, with spending so much time on the ship, so many nights, and exchanging telepathy and light codes with the star beings, again, which are not linear, having to be forced into a linear world, so to speak, it was very challenging for me. So my mother had difficulty with really accepting who I was. I think, again, on a subconscious level, she knew.
You talked about it as a child.
I did not because I knew it was smart not to talk about it.
Yeah, me too. I was the same boat.
So I did not talk to my parents about it.
I think my father knew about it. I think he orchestrated it, but we never talked about it. And he's passed on, so I can't be sure. And now, when you say you were on ships, was this a physical movement or not? Or can you tell?
So I had many experiences because I started being on the ship around 3 years old and was on this particular ship up through my teens, into my late teens in a class. So the ship I consider to be holographic. You know, it can have form or not have form. And it's organic. It has its own consciousness. And when one with the star beings, they can set their intention. The ship can be wherever in an instant, wherever they want it to be. So we call it a ship. To me, it's a geometric form in that it's all energy. It's frequency. And so all of that is set up on the ship. And so I loved being on the ships. I had a great time in that these beings were loving. They loved unconditionally. They knew how to do that. They knew that they were all one. And they were aware that I was in a class with seven other children. And so they would talk to us, you know, they would say to me, "You're a soul. We've known your soul many lifetimes, even though you're in a little girl's body. You are the soul," and would talk to me. About I understood the multidimensionality of the soul and that everything is consciousness. And I learned that at a very early age because of being on the ships. And the ship could move in and out of dimensions, or what I just call frequencies, in an instant because they knew how to set their intention, and everyone was of one mind in the ship. And so they could just be there. It's not like trying how many humans think it might be of being in a ship and taking 100 light years to get somewhere. It's more of, I call it hyper jumping into these other dimensions that are simply frequencies. It's all about frequencies and that. So the ship was amazing. It was like I was floating, not walking on the ship. And those who I call my star parents, Zazu and Amita, they were my key connection on the ship. And I spent a great deal of time with them.
Now, you mentioned being in a class with other children. You said seven or six other children?
Seven others, and then myself.
And then yourself. Do you know these children in this life at all, or can you tell where they are, who they are?
Yeah, well, actually, there are three of them who I know in this life. And there were children from other countries who were on the ship, but we could all understand each other telepathically, even though we spoke different languages. So there is a gentleman who I know him now, who I speak to, who was on the ship when we were children, which was great fun. There was a young boy who I grew up with in the neighborhood who was, we were friends actually until we were about 10 years old and then I moved, but we were on the ship together and were very close. And later on, we actually had some hybrid children together, which was planned, and that was fine.
Now, you say you had we're going to get into the children you had together in just a moment. We're going to take a brief break right now for Free Dreamlanders, and subscribers will just keep on keeping on. We'll be right back. 2 years in the writing, my new book, Them, is finally ready to go. It will be published in Kindle and as a paperback on March the 23rd on Amazon. Later, it will be published as a hardcover and as an audio book. Them is a departure. There is nothing like them. It is the first book of its kind, a completely new way of looking at the close encounter experience, a deep exploration of both the civilian and military experience of contact with the visitors, and both have been very profound. Much of this material is simply not known, but I go into it, I think, more deeply than anyone ever has before. I don't talk about my own experiences in this book, but rather about the experience itself. Them. Mitch Horowitz calls it in the preface among the most important interpretations of visitor phenomena since Jacques Vallée's Passport to Magonia in 1969. Dr. Vallée says in his foreword, the book cites fact after fact to build the case for in-depth realignment of public policy and public need. Diana Walsh Pasulka, author of American Cosmic, says, leads the way, and it's best that we listen because the stakes have never been higher. EarthTech International President Hal Puthoff says, them is exceedingly valuable. Leslie Kane, author of UFOs, Generals, Pilots, and Government Officials Go on the Record, says, groundbreaking in the truest sense of the word. Bigelow Aerospace VP Colm Kelleher says, searing and masterful. Them, a new vision and a new way of looking at close encounter. You have never read anything like them before. It is the beginning of a new way of looking at our own future. We're talking to Jacquelin Smith. Her new book, Star Being in the Mirror, My Journey as a Hybrid. Her website, jacquelinsmith.com. That's Jacquelin with no E on the end, Jacquelin Smith.com. And let's talk a little bit about these other children. You were talking about one you had known and you had children with.
Yes.
How did that work? Because obviously it was, you're not talking about something that happened in this level of reality. Or are you?
It happened on a ship, actually. So there are lots of ways of creating hybrid children depending on the race. So the experience that he and I had was, you could say, very human. And so what they did was then they removed the embryo from me to use to make the hybrid children. And they have their reasons for how they choose to create the hybrid children. So when I was in my teens, they implanted me with some embryos and then they removed them. And they had this really amazing way of going in with like this tube of light and very gently being able to remove the embryo. So for me, I was not in discomfort or pain. But later on, when I was older in that, they shared with me that they could just take a strand of my hair and create as many hybrid children as they wanted to. So that's why I have so many hybrid children. And so they talked to me about this, how they continue to learn. You know, as we're learning and evolving, so are they. But they took a strand of my hair. And from that, I had actually three hybrid children that I could communicate with and sense that they had implanted in my aura, you could say. And so they were there. And at one point I asked them to please remove them because I was getting too attached to them.
Oh,
so
yeah, I can see that in your face.
So so they did remove them, which was fine. And another way I had an incredible experience on the ship with a race called the Mantis. And it was very different. It is a spiritual experience. It has nothing to do with sex or gender. So this Mantis being and I merged. And in the merging of our energetic fields, I immediately looked over and here were these hybrid Mantis beings and they were very small. And I'm thinking, oh, aren't they cute and darling? And within minutes, I was watching them grow up before my eyes. So the star beings have a way of being able to allow them to grow up at the speed they choose. And so it's not like it is here on Earth, all those stages. And the Mantis are master geneticists.
They're also masters of time.
Absolutely. Time, and they help to create the cosmic grids. And so I'm very close to Mantis beings as well as my star family. And I call him my nanny on the ship, who was Arcturian Zeta, who would take care of me sometimes. And we would play catch with energy balls of light that we would create that I was learning on the ship and learning a lot of other things in the classes as well. I mean, we had many amazing experiences So they were teaching us to use our minds and how to create, to materialize. So we would think of animals or trees, and then they would materialize on holographic screens that they had. And one experience that I will never forget is they literally moved us outside of the ship and into space. I call it, we could call it a a sub bubble of space or dimension. So all eight of us children were in that bubble, and we were being taught basically quantum physics, looking at other planets and stars, and they showed us Earth and were telling us how much they loved Earth, that their intentions were good. We each had our own missions, and they were teaching us in ways individually, but also as a group, what we had chosen, what our souls had chosen to do here on Earth, our missions. So
now you mentioned having embryos removed from you, and in a way that it obviously wasn't traumatic. In my case, and in the case of many women who've had embryos removed, it is very traumatic. I had semen taken.
Yes.
And you also, another difference is that the children that have come from you are not something, they seem to be, and we'll talk a little bit more about them, well put together, I should say. The child that came from me, that I'm fairly sure came from me, was in this physical level of reality. He was a physical being, and he was not happy. He had a very, very, very hard situation in that he could apparently hear thought, but couldn't turn that off, meaning that he was like a schizophrenic. He was hearing voices in his head, only in his case, the voices were the brain, were the thoughts of other people. And he was terribly, terribly distressed.
Aww.
And I finally, and I regretted this for the rest of my life, I drove him off when he followed us from our cabin in upstate New York to the little condo we had, which was all we had left in Texas after I went bankrupt, and I drove him off. And I think that I rejected my own child, and it's very hard. You didn't have this experience, and I would like you to tell us what your experience of your children is.
I love my hybrid children.
I love mine too, only I'm...
Right. And
I understand what you're saying, though.
So most of the hybrid children that have been created are well, are working in other star systems. They share with me what they're doing. And I do have a hybrid child who is on this level and was integrated here a number of years ago. And actually, she's in another country. We talk telepathically. She's a healer, has two children and a husband. And so we have this clear telepathic link. And I'm very grateful for that. And sometimes I want to run off and try and find her, but I know that's would not be the best thing for either of us. So she's here doing her work. And I think that this is happening more and more, that the star beings are integrating more hybrids onto this level to help with the evolutionary process with humanity. My other star children, as I mentioned, are in other galaxies. I have a son who I don't even have words for it, but he's kind of like a light engineer where he's creating all kinds of light, energetic frequency paths throughout different galaxies and that. So he's doing his own evolutionary process. I've talked to many hybrid children, mine as well as other people's hybrid children. And they're not so different from us in some ways. They're might sound kind of silly, but there are artists, you know, they do art, poetry. They are very creative beings, those who I have communicated with, and they love to create. And so, but my hybrid children speak to me with one voice, and they kind of laugh at me sometimes because I still think of them as children. But because of who they are as hybrids, of course, they're not children. And so they're highly developed beings.
I think that we are, I can't say for sure, but it almost sounds like that there's a light side to this and the dark side. And I'm tangled up with the dark side. And you're tangled up with the light side. That's how it feels to me anyway. Let me ask you this. There's all of this work going on, work with light and so on and so forth. What is its aim? Where is this universe going? And it's an interesting question to me because I think you might have some fascinating thoughts about that.
Well, I think that my perception and what I've learned with the hybrid children is it's all about the evolutionary process. And that this universe, all other universes, we could say the multiverse, is always growing and expanding in consciousness. And so there are, gosh, all these different beings who we are all actually helping each other to grow and to evolve. So again, I am a clairvoyant, clairaudient, and all of that, clairsentient. So when I look into other dimensions and other worlds, which the star beings have shown me and continue to show me, is that they're always evolving and shifting and changing, and that everything is frequency. They do not think in a linear way as humans do. So everything is multidimensional. You know, everything's going on at once. And so it's about growing, learning, expanding spiritually, and understanding. I think of as all forms are, you know, if all forms drop their skin or quasi physical skin or whatever we want to say, we're all light, you know, and I think of us as all divine love as well. But we're,
you
know, all...
you've got a friend in Albert Einstein who described the physical world as energy slowed down, which was,
yes,
that is to say light slowed down.
Exactly.
Oh, wait. We're just coming up on a break, and it's a perfect time to take a break. So we're going to take a brief break, and we'll be right back.
UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, transformation, the secret school, breakthrough, majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations. But more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
2 years in the writing, my new book, Them, is finally ready to go. It will be published in Kindle and as a paperback on March the 23rd on Amazon. Later, it will be published as a hardcover and as an audiobook. Them is a departure. There is nothing like them. It is the first book of its kind, a completely new way of looking at the close encounter experience, a deep exploration of both the civilian and military experience of contact with the visitors, and both have been very profound. Much of this material is simply not known, but I go into it, I think, more deeply than anyone ever has before. I don't talk about my own experiences in this book, but rather about the experience itself. Them. Mitch Horowitz calls it in the preface among the most important interpretations of visitor phenomena since Jacques Vallée's Passport to Magonia in 1969. Dr. Vallée says in his foreword, the book cites fact after fact to build the case for in-depth realignment of public policy and public need. Diana Walsh Pasulka, author of American Cosmic, says, leads the way, and it's best that we listen because the stakes have never been higher. EarthTech International President Hal Puthoff says, Them is exceedingly valuable. Leslie Kane, author of UFOs, Generals, Pilots, and Government Officials Go on the Record, says, groundbreaking in the truest sense of the word. Bigelow Aerospace VP Colm Kelleher says, searing and masterful. Them, a new vision and a new way of looking at close encounter. You have never read anything like them before. It is the beginning of a new way of looking at our own future. We're talking to Jacquelin Smith. Her website, jacquelinsmith.com, no E after the N in Jacquelin. Her new book, Star Being in the Mirror, My Journey as a Hybrid, and it's quite an interesting journey. And as you know, folks, I'm not an evaluator. In other words, I'm not saying, well, this sounds true and that doesn't sound true. To me, that's a lot of pretentious nonsense because of what I've been through. I have no idea what has happened to Jacquelin and the level of reality it is. And I don't think as a Western thinker mind anymore. I've been cured of that disability I'm simply accepting what is here before me. And this is how I have to live my life, because I live an impossible life. I'll tell you something that happened a couple of nights before, just two nights ago, when I was sitting in my living room and I was thinking about, what am I going to talk about with Jacquelin Smith? And suddenly a disembodied presence, and I could feel it, just came in and threw its arms around me, and I felt incredibly loved. And I thought to myself, well, this is a switch, because usually the visitors I'm with are pinching me and making me wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning to meditate and go on. And you're laughing. And what, this is delighting you. Tell me more. Why is that?
No, I'm just appreciating how you are saying this, you know, the differences. And
yeah. And because it's one of the main reasons I wanted so badly to have you here, because I'm interested in the differences. I'm not closed to anyone who has been through what I've been through and has still had a closed mind about this stuff. They weren't worth the attention they got, because you got to have an open mind with this. Well, listen, I want to go on though with there's so much stuff. Toward the end of the book, you get into, it's just like sentence by sentence, and one reads it very carefully, and there's an awful lot in these sentences, this whole worlds and ways of thinking. Now, I want to, though, shift a little bit, because you have also talked about animals as star beings and the relationship with animals. Tell us the story of the spiders that occurs in your book. And let's move from that into the star origin of animals.
So there's a story when I went through what I call my Thanksgiving experiences, which was weeks of going in and out of different dimensions and going on a mothership.
And this happened in the, why do you say Thanksgiving?
Because it happened on Thanksgiving.
Well, you know something interesting? You probably don't know this, but for 6 years, a UFO appeared over Camarillo, California on Thanksgiving.
Really?
6 years running, yeah. And a friend of mine, Steve Neal, who is also an amateur astronomer, in addition to being an incredibly cool guy and model builder and all kinds of things, and close encounter witness, took a video of it through a Celestron telescope, because he knows how to do that. And you see in the video this thing flying along and going up and up and up and up and up, and then suddenly it explodes into a shower of sparks. And it was just incredible. But something about Thanksgiving. I thought that was a holiday we invented, and not actually a very nice one, because after all, it's Thanksgiving for having tricked the Indians into feeding us so we wouldn't starve to death.
Well, what's interesting too, Whitley, is a friend of mine who is a hybrid in California, he said on Thanksgiving that I flew by on a starship by his house.
How cool is that? And so tell us more about your Thanksgiving experiences, and then we'll segue back into the animals.
Okay. So, oh my gosh. Yeah. Incredible. And so the star beings had communicated with me telepathically. I was like sitting and watching TV, and they said, hey, that's my way of, hey, we'd like you to go outside in your backyard at midnight. And it was like really cold, and I was a little resistant, and I go, okay, I will. So I go outside in my backyard, and I see 7 starships in all directions. And I'm going like, this is incredible. And so then a portal opened over my house, and an organic ship came out of this portal, or a craft, smaller, but it looked to be physical, quasi-physical, interdimensional. And I was just standing there watching it, and it shined light directly into my eyes. I mean, and then it flew, as everyone says, more quickly than you can imagine. It flew south, and I was like, well, this is just amazing. I mean, so then after that, they said, you know, they wanted me typing all this down. So I would come in, drink tea, type it down, go back out. And they say, we want you to talk about this someday. And I'm going, okay. So then they contacted me several days later. And by the way, meanwhile, there are things moving around in my house on their own. I'm kind of used to all this. It's just
you're speaking to the converted here.
My life.
This place is a living being, as far as I'm concerned.
So
I know where you speak.
Crystals were moving on their own. I would lay a crystal on a table, and something told me to look under the bed, and it was under the bed. So the ship that had come out of the portal, the electromagnetic fields were simply wild. And fortunately, I had a witness who came over. She's a Reiki master, and she drove up. I asked her to come over to take photos of things. And she goes, do you get the kind of energy that's going on around your house and in your house? And I go, yeah, I'm living in it. And so, but anyway, so all kinds of things were happening in my house. So they took me, they said, would you like to go on the mothership? And I'm going, I'm saying, like, you really have to ask me. I mean, they know me well enough. I would never turn that down. And I've been on the mothership a long time ago. So I felt like I was in a movie. I saw a craft outside my window. I mean, it unbelievable. And I started waving my arms. Because I'm going, don't miss me, I'm here, come get me. And they told me to lay down, and then I was gone. And then I was entering the mothership. And on the mothership, I was with all kinds of different cultures of beings, and some I knew, a lot of them I knew, but they were in their, I'll say, star being form. So a couple of them I had to remember, and they had to remember me. So one, he kind of looked like a warthog, and he was kind of sniffing around the air. And I'm just like standing there in my human form. And then we recognized each other from a past life. So while on the mothership, they did lots of healings. That's when they had healed my eyes. I had asked them, I go, I'm going down the list. So I gave them a number of things. I had arthritis and it was gone. And so I also ended up doing healing while I was on the ship. And the ship, this mothership, is very large, like the size of a city probably. And so it was a real homecoming for me. And I felt like I was at home. My star parents, Amitha and Zazu, were there. And the one who I call Sandman, who was my nanny on the ship as a child, showed up. And I had just countless amazing experiences and sat with a council of beings. And they were talking about Earth and other galaxies. And so it was this beautiful round room that had like this holographic crystal in the center, and everybody perfectly could understand each other. It was, you know, that true oneness. And so when I came back, I had this other amazing experience. I was out in my backyard again at like 3 in the morning. And they wake me up sometimes at 3 in the morning and that. So I was in the backyard, and from behind the tree stepped a, I was calling him Octurian. He had beautiful blue skin, and I could see him perfectly. And this is at 3 in the morning. So he would come out from behind the tree and then go behind the tree. Well, being the way I am, I'm like, thank God the neighbors were asleep. They would have had me hauled away. I'm going, come out, I love you. You know, I'm safe. And so the being came out. And later I realized it was Sandman who had given me the incredible gift of pretty much materializing in my neighbor's yard. For me, wow. For us to reconnect, it was very emotional for me.
Now, what do you say to people who are listening to this or watching it, and they are thinking to themselves, gee, this doesn't happen to me. What's wrong with me? What about me? I want this too. I'm just as good. What do you think about, what do you say about that? Because I get that all the time. And I want to know, you know, there's something about compassion that my wife said that I cannot repeat enough. I asked her what compassion was. She's an extremely wise human being. She said, she didn't answer it directly. You would think she would say, oh, it's giving money to being open and hearted. And she simply said, each of us is all we have. And if you think of it that way, suddenly the other person becomes so valuable to you because you think this person is as valuable to themselves as I am to me. So what happens when someone's listening to you and they're saying, why not me? How do you answer that?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say we all have the innate ability to communicate with star beings. And we all have the ability within us to be anywhere we want to in any moment of consciousness. I mean, I'm just able to do this. We all have these abilities. And I think when someone, you know, this, I was chosen to do this. You know, some people are great at being accountants. Some people are great at driving trucks, some, you know, whatever. So for me, this is what I'm here to do. This is all very natural for me, but I do feel other people, I work with people with this, helping them to step by step open and to develop their abilities. And usually if fear gets in the way, that's what blocks it. Those abilities sometimes. So is everyone going to have the experiences I've had? You know, I think all things are possible, but for me, this is what my soul chose.
This is what you have. And I have what I have, a cigarette smoking boy and being blasted up the rear end and everything else. And I guess I can, you know, I don't necessarily think I chose what I have, but you know, it's a hard journey, but I can handle it. I'm a tough bird. God knows I've been dead for a long time. Okay. We're going to end the free part of the show and go on to into the subscriber area. We're going to circle back to animals. And I'm going to ask a question about a very interesting statement you made, that you were with one who looked something like a warthog, but who had been with you. You had had past lives with them. We're going to unpack that fascinating statement a little bit. Free Dreamlanders, as always, thank you for watching and listening to Dreamland. And come to Unknown Country. Join the community. It's a lot of fun. There's no place else like it in the world, because there's lots of places where there can be you can look and read and so forth, but this is a community. There's interaction here. You can go, you can be part of the community. It's even free to be part of the community. You don't have to pay anything to be, you don't have to be a subscriber if you want to join the message boards, et cetera, and so forth. So do join it. Jacquelin Smith, Star Being in the Mirror, My Journey as a Hybrid, jacquelinsmith.com. A fascinating journey indeed. So goodbye, Free Dreamlanders. See you next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.